Cody's is next.
Thank you, Lee, Steve. I'm wondering if you can hear me, I'm not seeing a microphone around here, can you hear me back there, okay?
No.
Yep.
Yeah?
Just speak up.
Well, while we're waiting, it's wonderful to be amongst former colleagues of mine from the city, as well as in the private practice, Graham McGarver, who's gonna be speaking later. I entitled this, as you can see, I think, Mind the Gap. We have a gap here that, in the fabric of the city, and it's a real opportunity. Anyway, framing, thanks to the micro photograph here, frames the argument for us. I'm gonna go from that big scale that the two previous speakers were talking about, down to the site scale at 555 West Cordova, immediately east of the waterfront station and west of the landing, shown here, just on the edge here. And the question you might have is, other half dozen or so people involved in this downtown waterfront working group, plus other people who are below, what we call below deck, who don't want to be identified particularly, but are providing advice. Why are so many former City of Vancouver planners involved in this work group? It's not that we're inherently negative about what the city does, but sometimes things come along that provoke you into taking a position. And 585, I think it was, Helmkin was one of those things that a group of people that I was part of, as well as others in this room were part of, to try to make a point about what the city is doing on what seems to be an ad hoc level. And so we got excited when we saw this plan, which is located right about there, using the aerials from the transportation plan, just to orient you. The yellow line is the hub study that Anita and Steve just talked about, so it's quite a bit of airspace and land around there. Here it is showing in plan view. It doesn't line up with any streets, so it's hard to call it a street end view, but nonetheless, it's an amazingly powerful view, and we think that missed opportunity of using that is really important, not to miss that opportunity. The transportation hub framework plan called for an 11-story building in that location. It does show, if I knew where the pointer was, it does show the Cordova connector coming through there, which is taking up half the space. So one of the framing questions I'm gonna have is, do we need that a full road space through there? And I think the argument can be made probably both ways. Thank you very much, Redmond. This road here, which I imagine is a 20-meter road allowance, which would be the same with the State House Street and other streets in the area. So we got excited about the opportunity here, but also disappointed with what was coming forward with the application. Excuse me, this is a very sensitive device. Another outtake from the hub study, and it's a wonderful diagram, I think. It shows sloping down in heights from the waterfront, from new buildings over the tracks and in this space, towards the scale of gas tech. To me, that's a framework principle. And it just respects the height of Gastown, which goes up to maybe 100 feet in some places, but generally speaking, 3, 4, 5, 6 stories. In the case of the landing, about 7 or 8. And it also says slope down towards the waterfront, which when you think the domical shape of the landform of downtown and having a similar domical shape for heights of buildings, where the tallest buildings should be in the middle and the lowest building maybe towards the edges at the water, that would follow that kind of principle. Again, not a bad one. Anita showed this plan before, or this sketch, but since this drawing was done for the hub study, I'm gonna stand over here because it's hard craning my neck. Since that time, approximately, the federal government has come in, so they have certain space needs for themselves. It could be up to 1 million square feet, it could be quite a bit less than that. But the interesting thing about that number is almost exactly equal to the 1 million square feet or so that is planned for over the tracks. So there'd be a framing question about what happens if this goes forward, will there be any demand left to build this road extension and get out over the waterfront? On the positive side, if it does happen, as Anita mentioned, the overpasses and other poor connections, and hopefully the street extension like this will eventually happen. And fundamental to our thinking in our waterfront group is whether this goes forward sooner or later. If it goes forward, it big implications, positive implications. If it never goes forward, it has large negative implications. So here's what was proposed. Luckily, the urban design panel did not give it the green light. I put a couple of red lines on this, this drawing. We're looking northwards toward the mountains and water. What you see on the left is the CPR station, which had a very strong parapet line at a high three stories, classical building. And we have a warehouse building from the late 19th century, the landing, very simple format, slab kind of building, also masonry, at about 7 or 8 stories. So those are good reference points when you think about neighborliness and relationships. Do you want to loom over your neighbor, or do you want to be more in keeping with your neighbor? Would this woman here be comfortable be talking to you like this? Or would it be nicer if I'm sort of down here and we're looking at each other and having a good conversation? The yellow line is approximately the height of the 11-story building that I referred to in the hub study. So you can see that more than double the height is being proposed in this application, generated by the view cone from Queen Elizabeth Park. Sort of a technical thing, but it's very, very important. It shapes an awful lot of our downtown. The shaded area here is the upper part of the proposed building, 18,000 square feet. The finer line in there is indicating the floor plan of the ground floor and tapering up. I have 1 minute, and I'm about 12 minutes away from finishing. So we'll have to see how we go here. It has this this kind of quality of being a small footprint and a big building. And we have one of those already in the works around here. Here's how it shows in the setting. So this is a comparison to what the hub framework plan called for on that site. And this is what the development application called for. And you can make the old assessments about whether there's any coordination between these two. So as much as I think the hub framework plan is a major statement and a good statement about the future evolution and a flexible statement about the evolution of the waterfront, when the first thing out of the box comes looking like this, you start to question the whole plan. The area has different intersecting grids. I'm not going to worry about too many of these things. These are the access points, what we have right now. We have House Street, a potential extension of Granville Street, and then the one here that, as Steve mentioned, would be right in and right out, should it go across at this location. We already have top-heavy buildings being planned in this city. I think of what's now called the Cube out there in West Georgia, which has got the suspenders. That's our first one, the little tiny footprint with massive building sitting on top. Actually quite famous in its day. And we got this one here at Canada House we proposed as well, for a whole set of other variables that affect that site. And the question to me is, how many times are we going to do that? So I'm going to go into our propositions, or our thoughts, mostly my thoughts. I'm not going to blame anybody else. We had the three levels. What's happening with the, we got the pointer on. No, something walking around here? Mouse?
You hit something.
Anyway, that blue line represents the 15 stories from the downtown east side plan and parts of Chinatown. So you can see above the 11 stories is a little bit of leeway to be sort of a taller building because of its importance, if it's a good enough site to do it. Yeah, I get the message. Okay, I'm sorry, I'm trying to do the best I can. And I think above that 11-story height, it has to be earned. There has to be performance qualities about public realm, about architectural design, about access, about what's the good for the city as a whole. Not good for just development, but good for the city as a whole. Do we have enough, with the red lines here, do we have enough circulation network, should Granville Street be built, to not need the city building? I'm hearing there's a bus, an important bus system, but could that be something smaller, just for pedestrians, bikes, and emergency, perhaps, and therefore you have a wider footprint for the building itself? That's one question. Another question is, Telus Gardens did an unusual thing. It somehow commandeered some of the airspace on both ends of the building for, I think, private enjoyment, I'm not sure. And, yeah. If that's indeed a good precedent, can we do a similar thing with that road extension rather than over CPR station, because the present design is, but lean the other way over the road and use it for public purposes? You're trying to get a bigger footprint of the building, which may bring down its height. Next slide, please. Can you do that? Should the implementation plan, and I haven't really talked about it, but it was mandated as recommendation B in the next 2009 council report, there should be a right implementation plan developed for the hub. The question is, that means detailed infrastructure, that means streetscape in public realm, that means the quality of things, maybe even design guidelines. What kind of character, forming characters of buildings have. None of that has been really done. So question is, in other cities, you don't get to build something until you've done that kind of implementation plan. So in a sense, is this a bookmark time until that implementation set is done, and through a public process? And what could be done to open up Granville Street sooner than later? I see a million square feet on one side being thought about. I see 375,000 square feet recently approved on the other side of Granville Street. We have a proposal here. Can any of the DCLs and CACs, those things, go forward and pay for that? And can residential use supplement and animate spaces of the tract, not be the dominant use? And if it is opened up, can the right-of-way through that site be reduced or eliminated and used only for bikes, beds, and emergency vehicles? And be a better neighbor, ultimately. Last slide, please.
Really, you're taking time please. Away from
Okay. We'll post this, I presume. Last slide, please.
There you go.
Hey, you're welcome.
As a consultant in the planning and urban design world, it's chancy to do this kind of stuff. It affects your career. So a lot of people who are involved in this have stepped way back. It almost should be identified for very good reason. But it is a risk to your career, and I'm knowing that personally. I just want to put that out there. Thank you.